Hello everyone! In this video, I'm going to teach you how to kite as a druid on Sabatha. I will assume that you know all the fight mechanics and have played this fight as a DPS for a while. If not, kiting may not be the best place to get started. This is also not a druid guide. Make sure that you are familiar with the class and have some experience with it on easier bosses. This video is divided into several chapters. The first few times you are kiting, you may only want to take a look at the first few sections of the video. Leave the advice in the last few chapters for you when you come back and have more experience already. The chapters are ordered by decreasing importance. Never let information from a later chapter interfere with something stated previously. Your main job, after all, is kiting flame patches. Make sure that you can always do this right. Why Druid? Every class can kite Sabatha. Standing outside the stack and baiting flame patches is very easy. However, when we build a team comp, the question we should ask is, which class offers the most? A druid is perfect for the job of kiting, since, for a variety of reasons, you should have a druid in your comp anyway. Druid loses very little by not having good boons, including quickness and alacrity on himself. Most of what druid does works at a high range. When you optimize the comp more and more, you will drop more and more support classes. If you kited on a heal firebrand, for example, you would at some point drop that heal firebrand. But you still need a kiter, and then you are sad because the class you've practiced with does not have a spot in the comp you want to play. Let's put it this way. Druid is the best kiter out of the classes that you always want to take in an optimized team comp. So, in this video, I'm going to explain how to kite on Druid. Personally, I don't think it's worth learning how to kite on any other class, as long as Druid exists in its current form. But feel free to adapt my advice to your favorite kiting class. If you are in a different class, then you can just skip the Druid-specific advice. Kiting. What is kiting? Sabatha has a very simple and slow auto-attack pattern. Every third auto-attack is aimed at the furthest person away from her. Once she has decided on the target, she takes another moment to aim, then she fires a big AoE in the broad direction of her target's position. These are the flame patches. Her other two auto-attacks are simple shots from a gun fired at a random target close to her. As a kiter, your primary objective is to kite the flame patch attack. The easiest way to do this is to stand at 900 range and fire staff auto-attacks at Sabatha to heal your group. If that is what you imagine to be your role as a kiter, you can now close the video. The rest will not be of interest to you. Okay, I think the terrible staff camping druids are gone. Let's share some secrets. Keep in mind that I have literally done this hundreds and hundreds of times. What I do as a kiter can get very insane at some points. You do not have to do all of that and can still be considered a good kiter that can carry his or her group. For me, kiting has become a challenge to take over as many mechanics as humanly possible. You don't need to do that, but it is fun to show that you can do it. Gaining agency. The most obvious downside of standing at range is that you, as a druid, would certainly like to be close to your group sometimes. If you are confined to the edge of the platform, you can't do anything advanced. So how do we break the kiting mechanic? Sabatha fires every third attack at you. This means that you have to stand outside the stack only for every third attack. Make sure that you get this right. Putting a flame patch on top of your group can be very bad for the health of your DPS classes. But learning how to move in and out of the group while kiting is the foundation of everything that follows. Additionally, Sabatha will not throw flame patches while she is not there or during her big flame wall attack. Feel free to move to the middle at those times. It is worth to note though that the flame patch attack after the flame wall is not the third attack of the chain, but rather the first. So don't be asleep, or you get your group burned. Giving might. Arguably one of your most important jobs as a druid is to give might. Coincidentally, the optimal way of giving might also includes some very strong healing. You will realize that once you're good at generating might for the group, you can also easily solo heal Sabitha, even if the rest of your squad is rather inexperienced at the fight. Giving might at range. While being outside the stack, you can use your avatar 1, 2 and 3 to give might to your group. What not many people know is that Celestial Avatar 5 does not give might around you, but instead it gives might around the target that you have selected. So as long as Sabitha is your selected target, you will pull might around her. I think this is a bug, and ArenaNet might fix it at some point, but for now you can use it to give might at range. Giving might in melee. All of the above still applies, but now activating Frost Spirit is also a valid option for another 3 might. And Celestial Avatar 4 is a strong heal, as well as giving 10 might to everyone close to you. When running a double heal setup, or if any scourges are present, it might be difficult for you to generate enough Celestial Avatar energy to go into Avatar every time it is required. For that reason, you can put down your Spirit of Nature. Spirit of Nature pulses a heal at up to 10 targets around it, including your other spirits. This solves almost all energy problems you could possibly have. Keeping the Spirit of Nature itself alive for the whole Sabitha fight is really easy, as long as it is somewhat close to the group, you will accidentally heal it while giving might. Going to Avatar whenever it is ready. Press the appropriate skills depending if you are currently in melee or at range, and you will have great might uptime very easily. We will revisit this topic later in the video, but for the start, that's all you need to know. Healing. Healing is done by the same means as giving might. In addition, Star 5 into Star 3 into Warhorn 5 is a nice blast finisher combo applying healing and regeneration. Star 2 is a decent heal over time. Activating Water Spirit whenever you are close to the group will apply regeneration to 10 players. If you do all of that and have a Spirit of Nature standing close and are going into Avatar off cooldown to give might, that's already enough to solo heal the encounter. So, this is a good moment to stop and try it for yourself. Move around the platform, go into the middle to reactivate your spirits off cooldown to apply their boons, keep your Spirit of Nature alive, provide healing and might for the group, all while making sure that you're kiting the flame patches properly. Practice this for a while. Being able to do this in your sleep is the foundation of everything that follows. Kiting Sapper Bombs. This topic is probably why most of you are watching this video. Here's how the bandit sappers throw the green bombs at players. Whenever a cannon spawns, which happens at XX30 and XX0 of Sabitha's Enrage timer, on the opposite side of the arena a bandit sapper will spawn. Exactly when he spawns, he checks the map and registers the person that is standing the furthest west. As part of his attack pattern, he throws green sapper bombs at the registered person. It does not matter where the registered person stands after the registration though. The first bomb he throws is typically 3 to 5 seconds after spawn. This has one restriction: when the designated target is not inside his throwing range, he will pick a different target instead. His range is a bit further than the center of the platform. Over time, you will get a feeling for it. As a kiter, it's very easy to be the westernmost person on each cannon spawn. Arguably more difficult is being inside his range when he throws. For the south, north and east cannon, being in range of the sapper is as easy as kiting on the western side, so you don't even need to move consciously. For the west cannon, however, you have to do two things. Number one, be the person furthest west when the sapper spawns, and number two, walk towards the sapper spawning east within the next 3 seconds to be inside his range when he throws. Note: this is not a good reason to drop a flame patch in the center of the platform. Luckily, the timing of the bomb throw coincides with the cannon player moving to the west cannon, so he typically will take over kiting at that exact moment anyway, which makes it easier for you to just move into the middle to quickly get the green bomb. It's noteworthy that if the West Cannon player is particularly slow at killing the cannon, he might return late to the platform and thus be the most Western player for the next Tapper spawn. There's nothing you can do about this, unfortunately. He will probably get the green bomb and you can only hope that he knows how to throw it. If you are in voice chat with your group, communicate with specific players that they are about to get a green bomb and make sure that they know where to throw it. The flame ball can also lead to complications, since it forces you to rotate around the boss and leave your comfortable position to the west of Sabatha. A full turn of the flame ball is completed in 10 seconds. Rotate accordingly so you get the green bomb. It just takes a little practice to still be the most Western player at the exact time you need to. With all the effort you have put into catching green bombs, make sure that you're aware of the cannon pattern as well. South, west, north, east, south, north, west, east, and it repeats from now on. South, west, north, east, south, north, west, east, south once again, and in rage, all cannons are turned on. Hopefully Sabatha is dead by now. You should learn the cannon pattern without a tactical overlay. If you need Taco at this point, you will unfortunately not be able to progress through the remainder of the guide. So make sure that you get used to looking at the enrage timer of the boss to read off the mechanics that are going to happen. This skill can be transferred to a multitude of raid bosses in all raid wings. This is, in all seriousness, a great place to stop watching for you as a druid player. No LFG group will ever demand more from you as a druid kiter. If you do all of this right, you can absolutely hard carry a group. The remainder of the video is intended as a bonus. If doing any of it makes you not being able to perform the tasks outlined above, you should always prioritize what you have learned so far. It is by far more important than anything else I am going to talk about. Let's address some small things in no particular order. Backup bombs. Whenever a cannon player goes to the cannon, he gets a 50 second debuff that prevents him from going again. That's the reason why you need two cannon players to cover all four cannons. There will be times where people miss their cannons. Do not worry. As long as a bandit zapper is alive, he will keep throwing bombs at you, so you can get another one from them. Keep an eye on the zapper so you observe his throw animation and know when you're about to get the bomb. This is mostly random timing, so it's hard to coordinate with your cannon player, therefore it's important to look at the zapper so you are prepared. If you send up your cannon guy now, he will still have the debuff for the next regular cannon timing. This causes him to skip the next cannon as well, and the problems repeat from there. This would eventually mean that each cannon lives about 15 seconds longer than needed, which is quite devastating for the platform health, while requiring you to rely on unreliable backup bombs. If a bandit zapper gets killed, you will miss an entire cannon. You have two better options. Send a designated backup player up there with a backup bomb. Or skip the cannon entirely and do it on the next round. The second option is typically better, unless you are already under heavy pressure or the platform health is really low. Just tell your cannon player to skip the cannon and not worry about it. Heavy bombs. They spawn only during ad phases. As a kiter, people generally make this your job. If you can safely do it while getting and throwing the green bombs, go for it. This is especially easy when they spawn on the western side. Otherwise, let another support player quickly press F. Interrupting ads. Some ads can be dangerous. A Celestial Avatar 3 or a quick Iboga F2 can easily interrupt them though. Since your pet is in the center of the arena, your F2 will pull the ad into the stack, where it gets immediately killed. Side note. Bandit zappers can be interrupted. Don't do that if you want to a green bomb from them. Kill flame turrets from Karde. This should really not be your job, but Warhunt 4 applies a lot of vulnerability. If you send your Iboga to a flame turret and throw a few more axe skills on it, combined with a Warhunt 4, you can kill a flame turret. This costs you a lot of time that is better spent otherwise in this stressful phase, but as a last resort, remember that you can do this. Flame balls in general. Sabitha always does the flame ball in the direction she's looking at the time she decides to do the flame ball. The attack has a 45 second cooldown and overrides all other skill priorities. During the flame ball, Sabitha is unable to do any other attack. With an average pack group, Sabitha will typically do the flame ball immediately after she returns when her champion hits 25% health. She always faces the same way upon returning, slightly to the northeast, so the position of the flame ball is very predictable. Coordinate with your cannon player, who does north, whether it's safe for them to go before the flame ball or after the flame ball. Remember, you get the bomb at about 7:25, so pay attention to Kernan's health bar. In groups with higher DPS, flame wall timings may be very different. In that case, make sure that you stand away from the group when Sabitha returns to be able to kite the flame patch. As a rough guideline, if one of the last things she did before she went away was a flame wall, she cannot do a flame wall immediately when coming back. The first flame wall happens at exactly 8:30, which coincides with the south cannon spawn. Coordinate with your south cannon player whether it makes sense to go before or after the flame wall, considering that you'll get the bomb at about 8:25. Be ready to throw the bomb. Precasting Nature Spirit. When Sabitha returns to the platform at 25% health and does a flame wall, her last add Carter is still alive. This forces you to rotate through cannon fire and a very dangerous flamethrower attack at the same time. Any player that goes downstate at this point immediately falls victim to the flame wall. For that reason, this is a great point to activate your nature spirit before anyone goes downstate, so you can immediately rest them when they do go down. Activating your spirits. A big reason to take Druid is your ability to give 10 people boons through the active effects of your spirits. Activate your Stone Spirit, Sun Spirit, Frost Spirit and Water Spirit off cooldown while you are near your group. This gives them a good uptime of protection, vigor, might and regeneration. Sabitha's Flame Walls and the Champion phases are both very good timings to do this, since you can be close for an extended period of time. Since you often don't have quickness during this fight, remember that your cast times are rather long and your Water Spirit heal skill easily interrupts your other skills. Giving Might, Part 2. Earlier in the video, I outlined a quite wasteful and mindless way of overstacking your group with might. In practice, this will cause your cannon players to drop might while they are away from the group and cause them to regain it only very slowly when they come back. Here's what you could do instead. Stack might at the start, stack might before the cannon player leaves, stack might when the cannon player returns and before the next player leaves, stack might when the next cannon player returns, stack might when the next cannon player returns, and so on. Unfortunately, this is not enough to keep up the might, since the Grace of the Land trait will only hold might for 24 seconds, but a player returns every 30 seconds. So instead you need to fit in another might application in between two steps. However, if you spend the full time inside your avatar, this will then not work out with the cooldown. So you need to actively leave your avatar early after giving 25 stacks of might. For reference, CA4 and CA5 are already 18 stacks of might. Then you need Frost Spirit and 2 more skills, or 4 more skills to cap out on might. Manually leave avatar immediately afterwards to allow it to go on cooldown and accumulate new energy. Baiting timed bombs. The final topic of this video is going to be the red timed bombs. It is a small DPS loss for other players to get one of those, since they need to move out of the group with it. Before we begin, let's clearly state that the benefit of handling this mechanic as a kiter is rather small, especially in relation to the effort you have to put in. The proper reason, and the only reason to do this, is to show off that you can do this, and to keep kiting interesting even after having done it a lot of times. So, if you have this mindset, then feel free to continue watching. It is unfortunately not possible to completely cover this mechanic on your own, since other mechanics have priority. However, each time bomb you do will be a bomb that does not explode inside a group, so consider each time bomb you get a success. Let's get to it. If you consider Sabbath's attacks to be part of an auto attack chain that consists of gunshot, gunshot, flame patch, then the time bomb gets assigned to the person closest to Sabbath, that is standing inside her hitbox probably, at some point during her two gunshots. It takes a good second for the time bomb to then appear on your head, during which you can already move out, and then some more time for it to explode. With practice, this timing will become very obvious to you. For a start, I recommend that you get a few of the easy time bombs. Number 1. The first time bomb of the fight is assigned to the player closest to her when entering the platform, so if you run in first, you will always get it. This one is free. And second, after each flame wall, her time bomb attack will probably be off cooldown. Unfortunately, her flame patch attack is also ready. She kinda starts her attack chain with flame patch, not with the gunshots. She first assigns a player a time bomb. Then she turns to the furthest person and fires at them. By being inside her hitbox when the flame wall ends and immediately moving out, you get to do both mechanics at the same time. These two are the bombs you can get in all fights as long as it does not interfere with throwing green bombs. Green bombs take priority. Now for the harder timed bombs. Timed bombs spawn every second auto-attack chain during the first shot of her chain, with the exception of those post-flame wall bombs which spawn directly before a flame patch. This means, for example, that after a flame patch you kite at 8:45, plus minus 1 second depending on how much she has to turn during her auto-chains, moving into the middle immediately gets you a timed bomb. If you do the same opening each time, you will be able to catch it consistently. Unfortunately, that is the last time bomb that can be caught just using the enrage timer as a reference. For all the other time bombs, you only have your auto attack chains to go off. One chain is with time bomb, the next chain is without. Repeat. Just keep track of this pattern. Now, if this was your only job, it's not as horrible as it sounds, since you should be counting auto attacks already to anticipate all flame patches. From my experience, it gets really difficult though, when all the other mechanics get stacked on top. If you also have to make sure to get the green bomb, you are not free to go into the hitbox when you need to. While throwing green bombs, you are typically also out of the stack. For that reason, don't set your hopes too high. After all, this mechanics is your absolute lowest priority. Your off heal, if you have one, your quickness chrono, your quick brand, your electric gate, they all can also do this mechanic at a negligible DPS loss. The only reason to do this for you, I reiterate, is to show off that you can do it. That's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it.